Hello friends, in this video presentation we'll be learning balancing of reciprocating masses in locomotive engines. The viewers of this presentation are advised to see my previous video presentation on balancing of rotating masses and balancing of reciprocating masses, because those presentations are fundamentals to this presentation. Let's try to understand a schematic arrangement of a locomotive engine. The locomotive engines are resting on number of wheels. The wheels are mounted on tracks. So these are the rail tracks. And a crankshaft runs between the two wheels. So this is a crankshaft. On this crankshaft, we have got two cranks, crank 1 and crank 2. So point to be noticed is that in a locomotive engines, we have got two cranks. The next thing that we should notice that the two cranks are at 90 degree to one another. So we note that cranks are at 90 degree. We have got a connecting rod for each of the crank, and we have got piston for each of the crank, and there are two cylinders. So we have got two cylinders, two pistons, two connecting rod and two cranks. We should notice that in this figure we have shown the cylinders are between the wheels. So this is wheel 1 and this is wheel 2, this is track 1 and this is track 2, and the cylinders are in between the two tracks or two wheels. There are locomotive engines where these cylinders are outside the wheels or outside the rail tracks. We should also notice that both the cylinders have the line of stroke parallel to one another and they are in the same plane. Because of inherent manufacturing problems, we have got rotating unbalance in the crank. So there is a rotating unbalance in the crank 1 and there is a rotating unbalance in the crank 2. Usually these magnitude of rotating unbalance is different and at different angles, but for the problem, when we'll solve some problems, we'll assume that the total amount of rotating unbalance mass is same for both the cranks. There are rotating unbalance in the wheels also, but we will find that most of the numerical do not consider the rotating unbalance in the wheels, but they do exist in reality. And then there are reciprocating masses. So if we see in nutshell, a locomotive engine has two kind of unbalance, a rotating unbalance mass in the crank and a reciprocating unbalance mass. Let's try to first understand why cranks are at 90 degree in a locomotive engine. Usually locomotive engines are double acting cylinder. So let us see the two cylinders from the top. These are the two cylinders. These are the inlet valves from where the high pressure steam will enter into the cylinder. And these are the two ports from where the low pressure steam is going to be exhausted. Now, when the steam enters from the left port, the piston will travel towards from left to right. So from left to right. And when the high pressure steam enters from the other end, the right side, right port, the piston will move from right to left, and the low pressure steam will exhaust from the left end or left port. So when steam enters from right port, piston travels towards from right to left. If both the cranks are kept at same angle, both the engines will produce same power at the same time, which will give peaks and valleys in the power output, as the power produced is not same at each angle. Moreover, when the engine stops and if the pistons are near the dead center, the locomotive will not start due to lack of steam power, that is P into V, pressure into volume entering into the cylinder, because there will be very small pressure into volume. The total volume of steam would be less. If let us say the steam is entering from here, there will be large volume, but it will not move forward because it will not have inertia for the crank to turn. And if the steam enters from this port, let us say it is after top dead center, then the amount of volume over here will be too less to push the piston to overcome the inertia of the engine. And that is the reason why we have got the two cranks at 90 degree. So if let us say it stops in this position, one of the piston is at top dead center, then other will be somewhere in the mid stroke, and therefore there will be enough of steam pressure and volume available in at least in one cylinder to overcome the inertia of the cylinder of the engine. So that is the reason why we have got cranks at 90 degree. So if the cranks enter are at 90 degree, then there will be sufficient pressure and volume of steam in at least one cylinder to restart the locomotive. Now let's try to understand the classification of locomotive engines. Based on the position of the cylinder, we have got inside engines, that is engine cylinder between the wheels, and there are outside engine, that means we have got engine cylinder outside the wheels. In many locomotives, we have a coupling rod connected to the wheels on the same track. So based on that coupling rod, we can have an uncoupled engines where there is no coupling link between the wheels on the same rail. And there are coupled engines where we have got a coupling link between the wheels on the same rail. These coupling links are also unbalanced masses, and those are also to be balanced. So for engines which are coupled will have six planes for balancing, and for the engines which are uncoupled, there will be four planes. The four planes would be the planes of the wheels and the planes of the engines or the cylinders. Let us recollect the slide from a previous presentation, forces in the slider crank mechanism. We remember that we have said that there is an inertia force Fi for a connecting rod and a crank assembly. We also said that inertia force is given by MRE, that is the mass of reciprocating parts into crank radius R into angular speed omega into cos theta plus cos 2 theta by N. We also said that this can be divided into two parts based on the two components in the bracket, a cos theta component and a cos theta plus N component. So we say that F primary is MRE into R omega square cos theta, and F secondary is MRE R into omega square into cos 2 theta by N. For this case also, for this presentation also, we will consider only primary component and we will ignore the secondary component. The reason for ignoring the secondary component is that usually L is quite larger than R, and therefore L by R ratio is quite large, and therefore N is large. If the N is large, then F secondary would be less. So because the F secondary is very small, for large N values, we can safely neglect F secondary. You remember that we had talked of partial balancing in the locomotive. Partial balancing of locomotive give rise to disturbing unbalanced forces and couples. So we'll try to understand what happens because of the reciprocating masses, the unbalanced reciprocating masses in a locomotive engine. We provide a balancing mass MBRB, which is partially balancing the MRE R omega square with a fraction C. So we have got a theta component over here, a cos component. The unbalanced force along the line of stroke give rise to two effects. One is known as variation of tractive effort, and second is known as swaying couple. So a horizontal component will give rise to two effects. Now this balancing mass will produce a vertical component, and because of this vertical unbalanced component, we have got one more effect which is known as hammer blow. So the unbalanced force along the line perpendicular to the line of stroke gives rise to hammer blow. So we are going to learn three effects in this video presentation. We start with variation of tractive effort. Let us say that The crank of first cylinder at any instance is at an angle theta with respect to horizontal, which is the line of stroke. So this is a crank 1. This will generate FHU1. H stands for horizontal, U stands for unbalanced, and 1 for the cylinder 1. So FHU1 is the unbalanced force in the along the line of stroke. Now we have already seen that the second cylinder will have the crank at 90 degree to the previous one, and therefore we will have the other crank at angle 90 plus theta from horizontal, and it will generate a force which will be given by FHU2, that is a horizontal unbalanced force for crank 2. Now because these two are in the same plane, they will generate a total linear force along the rail track or along the line of stroke. So vector sum of unbalanced force produced by both the cylinder along the line of stroke, in this case it is horizontal, is known as variation of tractive effort. So let us try to mathematically derive how much is the variation in the tractive effort. Let MRE be the mass of reciprocating parts of each cylinder. Practically they are different, but theoretically we will consider both are same. Let R be the crank radius. Let omega be the angular speed of the crank, which is same for both the cranks. Let C be the fraction of reciprocating mass balanced in each cylinder. Thus the horizontal unbalanced force for cylinder 1, which is given by FHU1, is given by FHU1 is equal to 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta. Please refer to my equation number 3 for the presentation balancing of the reciprocating masses. So let us name this as equation number 5. Similarly, horizontal unbalanced force for cylinder 2 can be given by FHU2, where FHU2 is given by 1 minus C MRE R omega square into cos of 90 plus theta. Now we know that cos of 90 plus theta can be written as minus sine theta, and therefore FHU2 can be written as minus of 1 minus C MRE R omega square sine theta, and let us name it as equation number 6. The total unbalanced force for the assembly of the cylinder is given by FT, and FT is given by FHU1 plus FHU2, which is from equation number 5 and 6. We can write it as 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta minus 1 minus C MRE R omega square sine theta. Now adding the two, we have got 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta minus sine theta. Let us say this is equation number 7. This equation will help me to find the tractive force FT at any angle theta. Because the theta is varying, the variation in tractive force, that means the tractive effort, will keep on varying along with the angle theta, and at certain angle it will become maximum. So we'll try to find at which angle theta it is maximum and at which angle theta it is minimum. So we need to find maximum and minimum tractive force FT. The tractive force will be maximum or minimum when cos theta minus sine theta is maximum or minimum. If you see the equation number 7, C is constant, MRE is constant, R is constant, and omega is constant, and therefore the maximum value is only dependent on cos theta minus sine theta. So let us take dFT by d theta is equal to 0, and then dFT by d theta is equal to d by d theta of 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta minus sine theta. And then differentiating the above equation, we get minus sine theta minus cos theta equal to 0, and cos theta is equal to minus sine theta, therefore tan theta is equal to minus 1, or theta is 135 degree and 315 degree. So we will substitute theta is equal to 135 degree in equation number 7, and then theta is equal to 315 degree in again equation 7, and we will find the maxima and minima of the tractive effort. So let us start substituting the values. Minimum value of tractive effort is given by FT minimum, And FT minimum is 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos of 135 minus sin of 135. So finding out the values of cos 135 minus sin 35, we get minus root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. Now we will find the maximum value of tractive effort, which is given by FTmax, and FTmax will be at theta is equal to 315 degree. So equation will be 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos 315 minus sin 315. Finding the values of cos 315 minus sin 315, we get FTmax is equal to root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. So we can combine the two equation for FTmax and FTmin, writing plus and minus. Therefore, maximum and minimum value of tractive effort is given by FT is equal to plus minus root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. And this is equation number 8. Now we'll see how to find the value of swaying couple. Go on to the next swaying couple. Now looking to the two cylinders from the top, let us say this is cylinder 1 and this is cylinder 2. This is the line of stroke for cylinder 1 and this is the line of stroke for cylinder 2. This is a central line or central plane, which is a vertical plane. The two cranks, we can see they are at 90 degree. Let L be the distance between the two line of strokes. So the distance of each line of stroke from the central plane will be L by 2. FHU1 and FHU2 are the forces acting on cylinder 1 and cylinder 2, which we have already derived in equation number 5. Now net horizontal force FHU1 and FHU2 due to reciprocating masses along the line of stroke of the two cylinders are parallel to one another, and thus they produce a couple about the central plane. So because these two forces are acting parallel to one another about this plane, central plane, it will generate a couple, a positive couple and a negative couple. And now we will calculate this value of couple. This couple tends the engine to sway in clockwise and anti-clockwise sense about the vertical axis in every cycle. Thus it is named as swaying couple. Let L be the distance between the line of stroke of two cylinders. Let theta be the crank angle for first cylinder at any instance with respect to horizontal. Thus the crank angle of the second cylinder with respect to horizontal will be 90 plus theta. Now unbalanced force for cylinder 1 is given by FHU1. We have C equation number 5. It is 1 minus C MRE into R omega square cos theta. Similarly, unbalanced force for cylinder 2 is given by FHU2. FHU2 is 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos of 90 plus theta. So we rewrite cos of 90 plus theta as minus sine theta, and therefore FHU2 is equal to 1 minus C 1 minus into MRE R omega square sine theta. Taking moment of these forces about the central plane, we find the swaying couple. And swaying couple is written as CS is equal to 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta into L by 2 minus 1 minus C MRE R omega square sin theta into L by 2. So we use previous two equations of FHU1 and FHU2 and substitute over here. Therefore CS is equal to L by 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta plus sin theta, and let us name this as equation number 9. Equation number 9 will help me to find swaying couple at any specific angle. Once again, we will find the maximum and minimum value of swaying couple that will be dependent on the angle theta. So we will adopt the same philosophy. We will differentiate equation number 9 with respect to theta and substitute and equate it to 0. So we need to find the maximum and minimum swaying couple CS. The swaying couple will be maximum or minimum when cos theta plus sin theta is maximum or minimum. To find the maxima and minima, we differentiate dCS by d theta and substitute equal to 0. dCS by d theta is equal to d by d theta of equation number 9, which is L by 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos theta plus sin theta. Therefore, minus sin theta plus cos theta is equal to 0, which gives me cos theta is equal to sin theta. which gives me tan theta is equal to 1, and therefore theta is equal to 45 degree plus and 225 degree. So these two values will give me the maximum and minimum value of the swaying. So we find swaying couple. Minimum value of swaying couple is given by CS minimum, and CS minimum is L by 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos 225 minus sin 225. And finding the value of cos 225 minus sin 225, we get CS minimum is equal to minus of L by root 2 1 minus C MRE R omega square. Maximum value of swaying couple is given by CS max. CS max is given by L by 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square cos of 45 minus sin of 45. Substituting the values of the bracket, we get L by root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. Therefore, we can collectively write the maximum and minimum value of swaying couple in a common equation, which is given by CS is equal to plus minus L by root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. And this is equation number 10. So equation number 10 gives me the maximum value of the swaying couple. Now we go on to hammer blow. To understand the hammer blow, let us consider that there is a wheel. Let us say that there is one unbalanced mass over here, and this wheel through its axle is supporting the weight of the engine. Let M be the total mass of the engine. Therefore, the total force due to the total mass of engine per wheel is equal to W is equal to mg. Let us say that we have provided a balancing mass mb at radius rb. Now, because of this balancing mass mb at radius rb, we generate some unbalanced force, which can be shown by this curve, a sine curve. Now, mg is the total force per wheel due to the dead load, and the mbrb omega square vertical force will be given by has a maximum value of mbrb omega square, and therefore the total force on the wheel will be W plus mbrb omega square, and the minimum force on the track will be W minus mbrb omega square. So this is the variation in the hammer in the load on the track, but because it is a cyclic load, it is known as a hammer blow. So let us try to define a hammer blow. The unbalanced force perpendicular to the line of stroke produces variation in force exerted on rail, which causes hammering action on the rail, and it is called as hammer blow. To balance the unbalanced reciprocating masses, we added a balancing mass mb at radius rb. The unbalanced force along the direction perpendicular to the line of stroke due to balancing mass mb plays at distance rb is mb rb omega square sin theta b. When theta b is equal to 90 degree, sin theta b is 1, and therefore the total vertical unbalanced mass becomes mb rb omega square. Thus, maximum vertical unbalanced force due to balanced mass is mb rb omega square. W is equal to mg is the downward dead load acting on a wheel due to the load on the engine, load of the engine. Now, net pressure between the wheel and the rail is given by W plus and minus mbrb omega square, and this is equation number 11. Now, we will solve one numerical based on the above understanding. Crank of uncoupled inside cylinder locomotive are at right angles and have 300 mm radius. Revolving unbalanced mass per cylinder is 200 kg and reciprocating mass per cylinder is 300 kg. Distance between the center line of the cylinder is 600 mm. The wheel center lines are 1.2 meter apart. Driving wheel is 1.8 meter diameter. Determine number one, magnitude and angular position of balance mass required at 500 mm radius in the plane of wheel. Number two, hammer blow at linear speed of locomotive at 100 km per hour. Variation in tractive effort and maximum swaying couple. So this is the problem. Let's try to see how to solve this problem. The first step will be to write the data about the problem in an organized form, we will notice that the edges is uncovered. Therefore, we have got only four planes of balancing. We should also notice that the locomotive is an inside cylinder. That means the wheels are outside and cylinder are between the two wheels. Crank radius are 0.3 meter. Unbalanced revolving mass per cylinder MRO is 200 kg. Unbalanced reciprocating mass per cylinder MRE is 300 kg. Fraction of reciprocating mass to be balanced C is 2 by 3. Distance between center lines of cylinder L is 0.6 meter. Distance between wheel center lines LW is equal to 1.2 meter. Driving wheel diameter capital D 1.8 meter. Radius of balancing mass RB, we see that it is small letter lowercase b, 0.5 meter. Linear speed of locomotive V is equal to 100 km per hour, and we can write it as 27.77 meter per second. Angular speed of the wheel to achieve is given by omega is equal to V by R, where capital R is D by 2, capital D by 2, which is 0.9. So 27.77 divided by 0.9, I get 30.86 radians per second. So this is the omega for the crank, or the angular speed of the crank is 30.86 radians per second. Now with this data, we'll try to solve the problem. As we did in the previous presentation, we'll first generate a table like this. Here, in the first row column, we'll write planes A, B, C, D. Now, because this is an inside cylinder, B and C are representing cylinder, and plane A and plane D are representing the wheels. Then we will write mass, unbalanced mass on each wheel. We'll write radius for each unbalanced mass. Then we'll find MR. We'll find L, we'll find MRL, and we'll find theta. So we go ahead for finding first the masses for unbalanced mass for cylinder B and cylinder C. Our aim is to find a balancing mass for in the wheel plane of wheel A and plane of wheel D. To find the total unbalanced mass or the total mass to be balanced in the plane of cylinder, we have to consider two masses. So we'll see a space diagram in a sort of a 3D kind of fashion. Here, plane A and plane D are the planes of wheel. Plane B and plane C are the planes of cylinder. So we'll try to put some masses MB. We'll assume MB at 0 degree. And we know that the locomotive engines have two crank at 90 degree. So we can safely take MC at 90 degree. So theta C is 90 degree. Then we have to put, or we have to provide a balancing mass at A and balancing mass at D. Angles we are not aware of. So we'll roughly, at any angle we'll show MA, and at any angle we'll show MD. So we have got MA at angle theta A and MD at angle theta D. Now to find the total mass to be balanced for cylinder B and cylinder C, which are equal, it will be given as MRO plus 2/3 of MRE, because MRO is totally balanced. So we have to provide balance all the revolving masses, and we are supposed to balance only 2/3 of the reciprocating mass. And substituting the values of MRO 200 and MRE 300, we get 200 plus 2/3 of 300 is equal to 400 kg. So the total mass to be balanced in the plane B and plane C are 400 kg. So we write those 400 kg, and the balancing mass to be provided in the plane A is MA, and balancing mass to be provided in plane D is MD. The corresponding radiuses are given. 0.3 is the crank radius. So we will provide for B and C, we write 0.3. But balancing mass RB is to be provided at 0.5 meter. So we write 0.5 over here and 0.5 over here. Now we'll find MRs. So we can multiply the column each component row wise for column M and column R and write the answer over here. So 0.5 into MA, 0.5 into 0.5 MA, 400 into 0.3 120, 400 into 0.3 120 and 0.5 MD. My next step would be to find or to decide which one is a reference plane. Now there is a tip to decide a reference plane. We will take reference plane as that plane where angle is unknown. Now we can see that we have already assumed mass B is at 0 degree, so we know what is the angle of mass B, 0 degree. We have seen that we have therefore the two cranks, because they are at 90 degree, therefore the angle of C is known to be 90 degree, but angle of balancing mass MD and balancing mass MA is not known. So I have got two options. I can take A as a reference plane or D as a reference plane. In both the cases we will reach to the same answer, so we will select reference plane as A. Once we select reference plane as A, we will give all the dimensions from plane A. So we write, give all the dimensions from plane A. From plane A, plane B is 0.3 meter, plane C is 0.9 meter and plane D is 1.2 meter. So we enter these value in the fifth column. So we enter these values 0, 0.3, 0.9, 1.2. Once this column is known, we'll find the couple column MRL. So MRL will be multiplication of column MR and L. So this is 0, 120 into 0.3, 36, 120 into 0.9, 108 and 0.5 MD into 1.2 will give me 0.6 MD. Angles MA, MD are not known. We are supposed to find, but we have already decided B is at 0 degree and C is at 90 degree. So we write those two angles. Now we'll try to find the last row, because this will not exist, because for a while when we'll make a couple polygon, we'll ignore this and we'll be, because this is anyway 0. So we'll start with these three rows. So we take last two columns, a couple column and theta column, and try to make a couple polygon. Now we remember the rule for couple polygon. To make the couple polygon, what we have to do is we'll start with 0 degree and we'll draw a line which is representing 36 to some scale at 0 degree angle. So at 0 degree angle, we'll draw a vector which will represent 36 units of MRL, that is 36 kg meter to some scale. Remember that we'll draw always towards the right if the value of MRL is positive, and we'll draw it towards the left if the value of MRL is negative. Now the next step would be to go to the plane C or mass C. So MRL for mass C is 108 and angle is 90 degree. We remember the rule. Once again, we'll start the next vector from the arrow of the previous vector, and angle will be measured from horizontal in the anticlockwise sense. So we measure the angle from horizontal in the anticlockwise sense, length representing 108 unit at 90 degree. And the last vector, when we join, we'll get the value of theta b and 0.6 md. So we join the last vector over here. Once again, we remember that the next vector, following vector, will have the tail starting from arrow of the previous vector. So we draw it like this. Now the CD, length of the CD, length of this vector will represent 0.6 md for the same scale. And to find the angle of CD, we'll measure it from horizontal in the anticlockwise sense. So from horizontal line in the anticlockwise sense, angle is 252 degree, therefore we get theta d over here. Okay, there is a misprint. Instead of theta d, it is theta b. Let us say this is theta d. So theta d is 252 degree, and 0.6 md we measure the length cd and find out what is 0.6 md. So by this we get cd is equal to 114 and therefore md is equal to 190 kg. So from this we could find md is equal to 190 kg. So we change the values, right? Now my next step is to find ma. To find ma, we'll make use of force polygon. We know that now 0.6 md is known to me, this is 114, so I can find 0.5 md also. So for now I will take mr column and theta column. So we make a force polygon. To make a force polygon, we use mr column and theta column. Once again, we start with 0 degree and 120 unit of 120 kg meter. So we'll draw an arrow towards the right such that the length of the line is representing to some scale 120 kg meter. My next vector C is also 120 kg meter at 90 degree. So we draw 120 kg meter at 90 degree. Remember that we are measuring from horizontal line always and measuring in the anticlockwise sense. The third one is 95 kg meter and angle is 252 degree. So at 252 degree from the horizontal in anticlockwise sense, we draw vector FD and finally close the polygon. The length of this red vector FA will give me the length 0.5 ma, and the angle of this vector when measured in the anticlockwise sense will give me the angle of the mass A, that is theta A. So we'll find by measurement FA is equal to 0.5, ma is equal to 95. So we get 0.5 ma is equal to 95, and once again ma is equal to 190 degree. So we get 190 kg. So we get ma is equal to 190 kg. So like this we can solve the problem. Let us try to closely see that the two masses over here are same on the two cylinders, and that is the reason why you get that same balancing masses. So this is a tip: when you are solving a problem for locomotive engine, you will have the two masses as same because RB is same. So if RB are same, then you will get both as same, both masses as same, but you should notice that angles are different. So you will get a different angle. So here I'm getting 252 degree and FA I'm getting 198 degree. So angles are different. So we have discussed a graphical method to solve the problem. The same problem can be solved by analytical method. Please refer to my earlier presentation of balancing of reciprocating masses. What we have to only do is to make a equation MBRB, LB or MRLB sin theta B plus MRLC sin theta C plus MRLD sin theta D equal to 0. Solve it. Then we'll go for MRL B cos theta B, MRL B, MRL C cos theta C, MRL D cos theta C, D, and solve the problem. Find cos theta from cos theta D and sin theta D. We can find the angle and we can find the magnitude. So we can same way we'll go for MRB cos theta B, MR C cos theta C, MRD cos theta D, and so on. So this is how we can solve this problem. Now hammer blow at engine speed of 100 km. Balance mass MA and MD are the balancing sum of rotating unbalanced masses and 2/3 of the reciprocating masses. So the balance mass MA which is 190 kg, it is balancing 400 kgs of unbalanced mass, which is sum of rotating unbalanced mass 200 kg and 2/3 of the reciprocating mass 300 kg. Hammer blow is caused only by the vertical component of the balanced reciprocating mass and is given by Ma dash is equal to Ma into C into MRE by MB. So Ma is 190 kg, C is given as 2/3, total reciprocating mass is 300 and total MB or mass to be balanced was 400 kg and therefore Ma dash is equal to 95 kg. So hammer blow is only affected by the 95 kg because the remaining is was the revolving mass. So hammer blow is given by W plus and minus MBRB omega square, see equation number 11. So hammer blow is equal to, now in this case, in this particular problem, W is not given. So we can remove W and or we can assume it is zero, but actually hammer blow is only MA dash RB into omega square. So which is equal to 95 into 0.5 into 30.862 square. So that is 25.236 newton. Now we will find the tractive effort and maximum swaying couple. So we use equation number 8, under root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. So under root 2 into 1 minus C is 2 by 3 into 300 into 0.3 into 30.86. So 40 plus minus 40,404 newton. And maximum swaying couple is L by root 2 into 1 minus C MRE R omega square. So substituting all these values, I get 12,121 newton meter. So this is from equation number 10. So this is how we can solve a problem on locomotive engines. Once again, if you have any doubts, you can email me your doubts and I'll try to help you out. Thank you very much.